I do hope that you guys enjoyed the November to Remember series. I hope it kind of lived up to the name billing. It was something that you'll remember. I enjoyed doing it. I'm going to do some other type of video concept for the month of December, a new series. I'm not exactly sure where it's going to be yet, but you'll find out soon enough. Now, you know, the month of November has come and gone. We saw a lot this past month in professional wrestling, primarily between WWE and TNA. So let me talk about some of the best and worst of what we saw this month. Now, you know, the first thing I want to talk about is the passing of WWE Hall of Famer and legend Maurice Mad Dog Vachon a couple of weeks ago at the age of 84. He's a man that I had the pleasure of being able to watch at the tail end of his career, but also be able to meet both in 2011 and 2012 at the George Tragos Lou Fez Professional Wrestling Hall of Fame weekend. He was a wonderful man to meet every time I met him. You know, he was very warm. He was very engaging, even as his body was betraying him and even as his mind was starting to escape him. He was still the Mad Dog to me. And, you know, I'm thankful for having the opportunity to meet him a couple of times, and he really was a legend, and you know, he was a badass dude, and he will be missed, no question about it. Now, looking at TNA, we'll start off with TNA. This month of November, you know, it was just what it was. I'll put it that way. Now, one positive that came out of it, obviously, was the death once and for all of the Aces and Eights, thank fucking God. And you got that hilarious ass Aces and Eights funeral segment this past week. You know, the bottom line is, you spent almost a year and a half dedicated to this storyline. And while I appreciate the fact that TNA actually had a faction, had a storyline, and stuck with it, and stuck with it, and stuck with it, at some point in time, you would think that as your audience is starting to dwindle and lose interest in this faction, as you were doing things to undercut that faction, that you would stop dragging it out just to be stubborn about this shit. That you would sit there and say, hey, before the people totally tune us out, we need to kill this shit right now. It still took almost a year and a fucking half for the storyline. What did the Aces and Eights accomplish? By far, beyond question, the worst, and I emphasize again, the worst, 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 worst faction in professional wrestling history. No question about it. And I'm glad to see him fucking gone. I hope Bully Ray goes away for a while, but I know he fucking won't. Fuck him and fuck the Aces and Eights. Do you know who I am? Yeah, we know who you are. Guess what? Nobody gives a shit. Go train some young guys. Help out the business that way. Because you're not helping out the business by hogging the spotlight, you fat ass. Hey, what else did you get from TNA this month? You've got the World Heavyweight Championship Tournament, which I've been a big fan of. I love the way they've presented this tournament so far. I also like the fact that they're sticking with the AJ Styles storyline. You've got Dixie talking about that's intellectual properties of TNA, and you can't do that. You've got him defending the belt at AAA in Mexico, over in Japan. They're doing what the WWE failed to do because of their stupidity and their panic and everything else that goes along with it, with the whole CM Punk and Summer of Punk storyline in 2011. With all the abortion that was, TNA is at least trying, whether you like it or not, they're at least trying to actually play it out. Now, this is a storyline that you actually should play out for a couple of months, not like the Aces and Eights that you played out for almost a year and a fucking half, and you damn near killed your company because of it. Someday, if TNA is gone once and for all, you're going to ultimately look back with all the stupid things that TNA's done over the years. And they are too numerous to name in one video because we could be here all night, brother. The bottom line is that was the worst thing in TNA history, the worst faction in professional wrestling history. I hope they never, ever fucking mention it again on television, period. It deserves the Benoit treatment, and I fucking mean it. Don't ever mention it. Don't ever make reference to it. Don't ever talk about it. While Benoit went batshit crazy, killed his wife, his kid, and himself, Aces and Eights went crazy and killed TNA for a lot of people and damn near killed the company for me. Never ever fucking mention them again as long as your company's around TNA. Please do us that fucking favor. Now going over to the WWE, this was not a great month of November for them. You know, now while you've got things that people were excited about, that was Roman Reigns and Survivor Series and his big huge moment eliminating four people. You know, you've got CM Punk and Daniel Bryan tag teaming. You've got the continued push of the Wyatt family. You know, let's look at that. Let's look at that. Because after they have Roman Reigns eliminate four people at Survivor Series, the next night on Raw, he's a part of a big tag team match, and Dean Ambrose gets the pin. That makes no fucking sense. And then later on, you're having in the show, you're having the Shield attack CM Punk again because it makes no fucking sense. It clearly is an indication of a bigger problem within the WWE is even when they do come up with some good character concepts, which they have recently, they have no fucking clue what they're doing. There is no vision. There is no long-term direction whatsoever. And if you argue that there is, you clearly are a freaking dyed-in-the-wool WWE sheep moron, period. Period. There's just no excuse for this shit. Speaking of no excuses, look at what happened on Raw this past week. So you have Daniel Bryan get taken by the Wyatt family, but you have his fiance backstage, a WWE diva, where monitors everybody knows are all throughout, is obviously not watching her fiance's match. You know, something that's supposed to be so dangerous that could potentially cost you life and or limb. She's not even watching because she's more concerned about going and getting a football autographed by Michael Strahan. This is such a glaring omission and such a glaring example of WWE insulting our intelligence by not paying attention to these most basic and fundamental storyline principles, these storyline concepts. You would think that if your fiancé was out there wrestling, you'd probably take the time to fucking watch the match. Not sit there, and after the match is over, you act oblivious to anything, and you decide to go get an autograph, only to later have the WWE say, oh shit, the same social media that we fucking live for to have our name and all this other shit trend on, is rebelling against us because of this glaring omission. We've insulted their intelligence once again. We need to hurry up and put out a tout video and pretend like we had this planned out all along. No, you fucking didn't, and you know you didn't. And if you did, and if by some reason I am wrong, which I don't believe I am, but if I am wrong and you did plan this out, you still lack any and all continuity. Again, why in the fuck would this bitch, when her fiance is wrestling against the Wyatt family, be not watching and then happen to afterwards go get an autographed football for Michael Strahan? It makes no fucking sense. And speaking of things that make no fucking sense, Survivor Series was a god-awful show with one of the worst pay-per-view main events the WWE has ever prostituted out there. You got a storyline that was evolving for a couple of months between Daniel Bryan and Randy Orton throwing in Triple H. So Daniel Bryan, Triple H, Randy Orton, all this shit. And then you go away from Daniel Bryan, even though you could have still went with him for another match here at Survivor Series, to hurry up and hotshot the Big Show in here. So that way he's going to feud against Randall Keith Orton at Survivor Series, have a match against him. Then that main event match sucks. You have Big Show put Randy Orton through a table, which you would think logically, I'm thinking about it, you're trying to set up to some type of table match or a TLC match or something at the TLC pay-per-view, only to now you're trotting out John Cena. And you're going to have John Cena versus Randall Keith Orton at TLC with both belts on the line, but it's not a unification match. This clearly to me shows that the WWE, just a few months away from WrestleMania, has no fucking clue what the hell they're doing. They have no idea what the hell is going on, and they clearly have not mapped things out and planned things out. How can you do that? You have one job to do. If you were on the creative team, you have one job to do. And that is not write shitty wrestling. If you are Stephanie McMahon and Triple H and Vince McMahon and Kevin Dunn, and you have one fucking job to do, and that is oversee the television product, oversee the creative process, and make sure we don't get abominations of plot holes like the freaking Bella Sloan, whichever the one hell it is, was that Brie Bella, who gives a fuck? She's not watching her boyfriend fiance's match, and she's more concerned about getting a football autographed by Michael Strahan, only to address it later on, but still acknowledging the fact that she didn't watch the match. Nobody can relate to that, because that makes no fucking sense. With all those monitors backstage, why would she not watch? And then you're sitting there, and you're going from Daniel Bryan and Randy Orton to Big Show and Randy Orton to now John Cena and Randy Orton. You don't know what the fuck you're doing. And that's your only job. How the fuck can you not have this planned out? How in the fuck can you not have a better clue of what the hell you're going to do? How in the fuck can you not have a clearly mapped out step-by-step process between now and TLC and Royal Rumble and Elimination Chamber and WrestleMania? This is arrogance of the highest order. This is stupidity of an even higher highest order. It smacks of laziness, incompetence, and pure stupidity. And the WWE should be ashamed of themselves. We shouldn't be ashamed of watching the product. We should be embarrassed of the way this company heading towards such a seminal event in their company's history as WrestleMania 30, just a few months away, has no clue what the fuck they're doing. Absolutely no clue. And that is a goddamn shame. This was a November to remember, but in a lot of ways in professional wrestling, it was a November to remember for all the wrong reasons. I hope I made this a November to remember for you with Off the Rope Show Central. I hope so. And hopefully December will bring some more great festive things, some great tidings, and some more great videos from me, if I do say so myself.